don't be weak in your quest for good. If you're going to do something, do it with ihsan. This conference is a perfect example. Wallahi, mashallah. I say this from my heart. Look at the sincerity that is so manifest. Look at the number of people here. Look at the organization. They are not weak in seeking good. If you're going to do it for Allah, then don't be weak. Be strong in your seeking of excellence.
أول عشرت ما حبوبي يا عيني هدني ختم ألمس.
Wisdom and courage, and I mean that. Wisdom and courage. This is the way of the Prophet ﷺ. Wise and courageous. Wise, but not wise at the point that he's losing courage. And courageous, not at the point that he is forgetting wisdom. This is the balance. The way you are wise with your project and courageous as to your resistance.
أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رجلا شتم أبا بكر رضي الله عنه في مجلس النبي.
It is narrated on the authority of Abu Huraira, may God be well pleased with him, that a man insulted his companion Abu Bakr while the Prophet of God, peace be upon him, was present.
حاولوا أن تتصوروا المجلس. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
God's messenger is sitting here.
حاولوا أن تتصوروا المجلس.
So imagine that.
وسيدنا أبو بكر.
So God's messenger and Sayyidina Abu Bakr
وكبار الصحابة
and the great prophetic companions.
يدخل رجل ويسب سيدنا أبا بكر في المجلس أمام رسول الله.
And a man comes in and insults our master Abu Bakr right in front of the Prophet of God, peace and blessings be upon him.
فجعل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يعجب ويتبسم.
So the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, began to look as though he was pleased and smiled.
فلما أكثر أي الرجل زاد بالشتيمة.
So when this man insulted him to excessively.
رد سيدنا أبو بكر عليه بعض قوله.
سيدنا أبو بكر he responded to some of what the man had said.
فغضب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقام.
So the Prophet peace and blessings be upon him was angry and stood up.
فلحقه أبو بكر.
And Abu Bakr followed him.
فقال يا رسول الله.
And he said, O Messenger of God.
كان يشتمني وأنت جالس.
He was insulting me while you sat there.
فلما رددت عليه بعض قوله غضبت وقمت.
So when I responded to some of his insults, you stood.
فقال له.
And were angry. And he said to him.
إنه كان معك ملك يرد عنك.
The Prophet of God said to him, verily there was an angel with you who was defending you.
فلما رددت بعض قوله.
So when you responded to some of what he said,
وقع الشيطان.
Satan sat.
فلم أكن لأقعد مع الشيطان.
And I did not sit with the devil.
These hardships, these calamities, these tribulations, these challenges are meant for the one who seeks the divine. Do you seek the divine? Do you? Oh, I do.
I am calling within the Muslim communities around the world, and in particular in the West, for a jihad of meaning. A jihad of meaning. Now it's time to understand you will not get your daughters and your sons following the light that we were talking about if we don't reconcile ourselves with the meanings of things. And not because we are scared. The first reaction as Muslims when you are scared is to put limits, to say, haram, 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 don't do that, don't do that. And isolating ourselves. Now we have to do exactly the opposite, is to be assertive with meanings and to interact with meanings. Not to isolate with fear, but to be assertive with confidence, wisdom, and courage. But it means that we have to deal with meanings, that we have to come with the deep meanings of things when it comes to Islam.
The word is tamhis. Allah saying that through the hardships, He puts the believers through a process called tamhis. Tamhis is a purifying process that you put gold through. You know, if you want to purify gold, what do? Well, you don't just kind of like look at gold or wash it with some water and it purifies, right? You gotta put gold through a lot in order to purify it. You gotta heat it up. You heat it up until the impurities are taken out. There is a lesson in the physical world. See, we have to understand that the same creator who ordered the physical world ordered the spiritual world. We can learn about the spiritual world from the physical world. We can learn a lot. And in order to purify gold, you heat it up. And when you heat it up, you remove the impurities. Allah puts the believers through that process. Tamhis. And this is through that heating up, through those hardships, we are purified. We are purified internally. Actually, we're also purified as societies. On a societal level, we are also purified. On a family level, we are also purified. So this process of tamhis, of purification by heating up, happens at an individual level, happens at a family level, and it happens at a societal level. Allah puts entire nations through hardship also to purify them.
Beautiful parable, especially for dark times. You know, we're not evil people, we're not bad people. Allah gifted us with something so pure and so refined. Someone says, man, I'm not capable of being a good person. Actually, you are so capable of being a good person. You are actually inherently good and incredibly good at that. Not just good, incredibly good. This passage to me was like, whoa, so I'm like lit up on the inside? How do I keep this fuel going? Because the fuel is not from inside, is it? The fuel had to come from outside, and it needs to feed, you need to clean it. And that's why Allah gave us this revelation. Allah gave us this book, so we continue to recite it, and memorize it, and reflect on it. And every time we do, the light gets a little stronger, and a little stronger, and a little stronger, and a little stronger. That's what it does. يَكَادُ زَيْتُهَا يُضِيءُ وَلَوْ لَمْ تَمْسُهُ نُورٌ عَلَى نُورٍ. But if we have different spaces, the spaces for women should be at the same level as men. So when we want to listen, it has to be the same quality. And even here, unfortunately, this afternoon during Jum'ah, we had sisters at the back saying, we were not able to listen. So we have to improve, even at trees.
Do not hate one another.
وَلَا تَحَاسَدُ
Nor envy one another.
وَلَا تَدَابَرُ
Nor turn your backs on one another.
وَلَا تَقَاطَعُ
Nor sever ties with one another.
وَكُونُوا عِبَادَ اللَّهِ إِخْوَانًا
And be servants of God. Brothers.
وَلَا يَحِلُّ لِمُسْلِمٍ أَنْ يَهْجُرَ أَخَاهُ فَوْقَ ثَلَاثٍ
It is not permissible for one who is surrendered to God to shun his brother longer than 3 days.
That it's impossible for man to love God and vice versa, because they're not of the same genus. This theology is known as deism. The first 6 presidents of the United States, they weren't Christian, they were deists. God is a transcendent creator. He's the first cause, the unmoved mover, who doesn't reach out to humanity, as it were. There's no imminent aspect. He's like an absentee landlord. St. Thomas Aquinas, the author of the Summa Theologica, the great synthesizer of Neoplatonism and Orthodox Christology, he agrees with Aristotle. He says, yes, there is, to quote Kierkegaard, an infinite qualitative difference between God and man. But how do we bridge the gap according to Aquinas? He says God became of the same genus. He became a human being. This is called the incarnation. Now we disagree with Aquinas and with Christianity, respectfully, in this regard. Not in everything, but we have to remember, especially those who are going to go into Western liberal academy, they're going to tell you there's no real truth, all ways lead to God, that religions have real differences, and that's okay. Right? Either Isa alayhi salam is God or he's not. It's a simple logic, right? The principle of contradiction, an Aristotelian logic. God becoming a man is neither scripturally consistent nor intellectually conceivable.
You know what? We don't have a lot to pick from. If there are good young men and women out there, if there are good young men and women out there, and our children, we trust them enough to go out into the real world. If we've trusted them enough to go to college, to get a job, to deal with society outside, then it is unfair and it is a form of dhulm by parents that you don't trust their judgment or even consider their opinion when they suggest
this might be a good man for me, this might be a good girl for me. You don't even entertain the idea because the ethnicity doesn't match. That is unfair.
But the same person can have all of those things, but if it is held in the hand and it is not ultimately attached in that type of unhealthy dependent way, then it can be taken without devastation. One of the most beautiful illustrations of this is a story that I love of Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, rahmatullah alayh, is that one time he was teaching, and note that Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh was a man who had wealth, he had business, he owned things, but it was in his hand, not in his heart. And so when he was teaching, they came and they told him, your ships have sunk, or some portion of your ships have sunk. And so what he did was he paused, and he stopped teaching, and then he said, Alhamdulillah, and then he continued teaching. And then a little while later, they came back to him and they said, actually, it wasn't your ships that sunk. We made a mistake. Again, he stopped, he paused, and he said, Alhamdulillah, and then he continued teaching. And when later on they asked him, he said that when I was first told that my ships had sunk, I stopped and I examined my heart, and I found it unmoved. And I said, Alhamdulillah, that it was unmoved. And then the second time, when you came back and said that it wasn't my ships, I stopped and I examined my heart and I found it unmoved. And I said, Alhamdulillah, that it was unmoved. These are the people who have things of dunya, but they are not in the heart, they're in the hand. And so if they are taken or they are given, that's not what shakes the heart.
Look, you look around you, and what we see around us, in fact, is a society where you have people around you, postmodernism is telling you there is no truth. Everything is relative. Now, when it comes to ethics and morality, it's as if morality is a dirty word. We don't use that now. Freedom is the word. Forget about limits. Do what you want and be free. We know with the neurosciences, we know with the reality that this is a superficial freedom. In fact, that's not true. When you think you do what you want, in fact, you do what they want. And they want are not people from behind the scene controlling everything. It's a culture which is based on consumerism, addiction, dependency, and then you are not free. You feel that you think that you are free, but in fact, you dress as they dress, you think as they think, and you buy what they sell. So this reality is, how am I going to liberate myself from that? As Muslims, I have the duty of liberating myself. And we see our kids, our daughters and our sons to be involved in the process and being consumerist and being also nurturing new addictions. New addictions to internet, to drugs and to fashion. Even with Islamic references. Now we have a new business in the world, which is the headscarf transformed into a fashion business. And we have, you know, people following, you know, a model, a very nice way of wearing the headscarf. And you ask yourself, are we now implementing the rule or understanding the meaning of modesty in Islam?
God's Messenger, blessings and peace be upon him, said, the angels seized or received the soul, meaning he died, of those who preceded you. So he was asked, have you performed any good deeds? He died, so they asked him, did you do any good deeds? He said, no. They said, try to remember. He said, I used to loan people money. So I would command my assistants to defer the term of those who had the means and to excuse those who did not. So God, exaltedly, He says, then pardon him. This is narrated by Bukhari and Muslim.
Let me finish with the elders first. It is unfair of you to put them in a land which is majority. All around them, there is shamelessness. All around them, there are opportunities not just for the slightest kind of faksha, but the worst kinds of shamelessness is easily accessible to them all the time, 24/7. It is in their face. And they fight all of that, and then they say, I want to marry a Muslim. It is completely outrageous for you to say, no, but they're not exactly our type. They're not perfect.
Musa alayhi salam was dealing with someone who was a tyrant. Ana rabbukum al-a'la. I am your greatest God. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending him. Idhhab ila fir'aun innahu tagha. Go to Fir'aun because he has transgressed. And when he was there, he was scared. Because this is power. As sometimes we Muslims facing the society, we are scared. And look at the wisdom. وَقُلَا لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. Speak in a nice way. We always have this in Islam. Wisdom is always the way you talk. اُدْعُوا إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكْ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِدَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنَ. Speak to them the best way. وَقُلَا لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. He is saying, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is responding, La takhaf, innaka anta al-a'la. Why? Because I am with you. I am with your wisdom. I am with your tranquility. I am with your peace. With peace, with calm, anta al-a'la. Not him. He thinks he is because he has power. You should know you are because you have wisdom, belief, and God telling you, with tranquility, at peace, in peace, for peace. This is where you are in this society. And then you get this, that every time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about Musa alayhi salam, is coming with this and telling him, إِنَّ لَا يَخَافُ لَدَيَّ الْمُرْسَلُونَ. Don't be scared. Don't be scared. The people who have a mission, Mursaloon, they have a mission, they are not scared with me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending the messengers, telling them, you are going to face power, criticism, aggression, much more than what we are facing now. لا يخاف لدي المرسل. Don't be scared.
What is needed for us to be the vital organs that we need to be is for this work to be rooted in sincerity. It has to be selfless giving. It has to be expecting nothing. In fact, perhaps expecting nothing but harm. Because if you think it's going to be easy, think again. Don't give so that you may increase yourself. But another meaning, which is so miraculous, which is so amazing, is it actually also means don't weaken in your quest for good.
That is a part of the world, especially in Western Europe, where 40% of people are atheists and another 30% agnostics, where a country like England, only 5-6% of people go to church. In Sweden, only 3%. In France, the bride of the Catholic Church in the Middle Ages, only 8-9%. And most of the people are atheists. At the other end, we have people who are killing for God, so they think. And they're not only Muslims. The army of God in Kenya and Uganda is not Islamic, it's Christian. And the BJP that massacres Muslims in Gujarat is not Muslim, it's Hindu. So it's a global phenomenon. Global phenomenon of extremism at the expense of religion itself. I could go on and on. Our life in this world is marked by extremism. And every religious person, whether Muslim or otherwise, has to carry out a spiritual jihad, an inward effort, to try to be able to recreate a balance within himself and herself.
I'm sorry, parents, the world is not what you lived in anymore. It has changed. Everything has changed. And you know, the one thing that doesn't change in Islam for Muslims is our principles. Our principles don't change, but our social realities change. Our circumstances change, our economic conditions change, and we have to adapt. We have to live in the reality that surrounds us. If you find people of La ilaha illallah that are holding on to their character, guarding their chastity, they're going to make good fathers and good mothers, then there is no reason you should be saying no.
May Allah Azzawajal make you and me of those who hear the words of admonition and follow the best of them.
اللهم نسألك بأننا نشهد أنك أنت الله الأحد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. اللهم نسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار. اللهم اجعلنا من الموحدين. اللهم اجعلنا من الذين يقولون لا إله إلا أنت لا حول ولا قوة إلا بك. اللهم تقبل منا دعاءنا وطهر به بها قلوبنا. اللهم طهر بدعائنا قلوبنا واشرح لنا نفوسنا وقو إيماننا وثبتنا على دينك يا مقلب القلوب. اللهم رحمتك نرجوه، فاللهم لا تكلنا إلى أنفسنا طرفة عين. اللهم اجعلنا نخشاك كأننا نراك. قو إيماننا، ثبت قلوبنا، واجعلنا يا رحمن يا رحيم من المقبولين من المحبوبين. اللهم نسألك حبك وحب من يحبك والعمل الذي يبلغنا حبك. يا رحمن يا رحيم، أنت الرحمن أنت الرحيم. اللهم ارحمنا وتب علينا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. اللهم نسألك الجنة، اللهم نسألك الجنة وزيادة. اللهم متعنا بالرؤية إلى وجهك الكريم يا رحمن يا رحيم. اللهم ارحم والدينا ووالدي والدينا. اللهم اغفر لجميع موتى المسلمين الذين شهدوا لك بالوحدانية ولنبيك بالرسالة وماتوا على ذلك. اللهم أكرم نزلهم ووسع مدخلهم. اللهم تقبل منا واغفر لنا وارحمنا وتب علينا. اللهم نسألك حبك وحب من يحبك والعمل الذي يبلغنا حبك. اللهم لا تضع في جمعنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا هما إلا فرجته، ولا دينا إلا قضيته، ولا شابا إلا هديته، ولا مريضا إلا شفيته. اللهم أنزل علينا جميعا سكينتك ورحمتك واغفر لنا وارحمنا. اللهم اجعلنا من أهل الحكمة والشجاعة يا رحمن يا رحيم. اللهم قال رسولك أفضل الجهاد كلمة حق أمام سلطان جائر. فاللهم اجعلنا من أهل الحق. فاللهم قو إيمان إخواننا وأخواتنا في فلسطين. اللهم قوي إيمانهم في سوريا وفي مصر وفي اليمن وفي برما وفي بنغلاديش. اللهم قوي إيمانهم، استجب دعاءهم وأنزل عليهم رحمتك وسكينتك. اللهم استجب دعاء المظلومين، اللهم استجب دعاء المظلومين، وعليك يا الله بالظالمين، اللهم عليك بالظالمين. أرنا فيهم يوما أسودا، زلزل الأرض تحت أقدام الظالمين، يا رحمن يا رحيم. اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا وأصلح ذات بيننا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. اللهم سامحنا وارحمنا وتب علينا وقو إيماننا. اللهم اجعلنا من الصادقين، اللهم اجعلنا من الصادقين، اللهم اجعلنا من الصادقين، اللهم اجعلنا من الصادقين ومن أهل الحكمة والشجاعة. يا رب يا رحمن يا رب يا رحمن يا كريم يا ودود، أنت الرحمن فارحمنا. وصل اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين.